change in length, the overall change in length, you have to consider the difference between the two, meaning one material will be under compression, the other will be under tension. And that was part of your analysis. And how do you determine that? We discussed in class, it depends on the CTE value. Okay. Number four was a Poisson's ratio problem. I gave you this one because I thought this would be shorter and a little easier compared to your quiz. This was, again, back to your homework problem and to your class example. Now, in this case, I didn't give you a drawing or anything except for the stress and the strain curve. First of all, you should have used that to find the modulus of elasticity. And how do you use this to find the modulus of elasticity? If you look at the curve, from 0 to 490 stress, or from 0 to 0.007 of the strain, there's a straight line. That straight line is referring to up to a proportional limit or elastic limit. The straight line proportionality gives you the proportional relationship between the stress and strain. And if you solve for the slope of that straight line, that gives you the modulus of elasticity. Now, there is no picture for the bar, but is there anything that says about multi-axial? No, so you have to assume just a simple axial problem. And the stress and the strain are given in terms of the axial in the picture, okay? So this is going back to a class example where we talked about, you know, change in length versus the change in the diameter given the axial force. And in this case, the diameter is decreasing, right? Decreased 12.7 to 12.67494. So you could consider that as your transverse direction, whereas I didn't give you any change in the length. I just gave the original length, I believe, 50.8. Okay, so you had to use the transverse, or you had to use the Poisson's ratio formula to find the, obviously, the Poisson's ratio, but you had to find individually the axial strain and the transverse strain, and then plug it back into the formula to find the Poisson's ratio. Okay, now some of you didn't even know how to find the modulus of elasticity. So you got stuck with the first part. And then, I don't know, some of you guys were like all over the place with this one. It was not meant to be a tricky problem. So I didn't quite understand this one. And if you were to use the Plie formula, PL over EA, for finding the delta, you couldn't have done that because you don't know the change in length. I just gave you the original. And you don't have the force P, right? So you could not have used that. Some of you guys tried that, actually. But questions about the test?
So, sorry.
Bobby? On
problem number two,
mm-hmm.
I used the Plie formula to find P, but in our homework and a class example of that one, we used a different formula to find P. It was, you used the same.
Okay, so now the Plie formula would work for one of the members.
Okay.
Right, but there are three or two, really two different ones, right? Because the outer ones are the same.
Okay.
So you cannot find the overall force P that should be applied to the horizontal beam without considering the other two outer bars.
Okay, but like, so you find, but you would find the P and then you would multiply 2 times P plus P?
You could find the P for the center one. Why the center one?
Because that's your first yield.
Yeah, but not for the other ones. So if you, like Bobby said, if you go back to the notes, we drew up this relationship between the center bar versus the outer ones, because precisely what Bobby said, the central one will reach the first yield because of its shortest length, okay? And then we use that to relate it back to, well, overall, there's symmetry, just like in your class example. We talked about the symmetry, right? Mm-hmm. So the displacement should be exactly the same. So meaning that the amount of delta, the change in length, should be exactly the same regardless of the outer ones or the center bar or the center rod, right? So using the delta, you can find the amount of strain that is induced in the outer ones. Using that strain, you can solve for the stress. Now, why are we looking for the stress? Because the force P for the steel rods is equal to stress times the area.
Yeah, that was the one that I forgot. Like, I had it in my notes, but it was like to the side and I didn't see it. So I was wondering if P was actually, or PLE was actually a way we could actually still solve it. Because I just
guessed, not entirely.
Like, you would have to find P for one and then do the whole. Okay.
Yeah. That's why I did not use the PLE formula when I showed you this example problem in class, because that will not work. Okay. Any other questions? I can tell you that if you go back to your notes, you should be able to find every single one of these problems, right? Okay. I wasn't going to do this, not for the second test, but if I don't do it, I'm afraid I'm going to see you guys again next semester for this exam. Bobby, I'm not just talking about you, Bobby, so don't feel bad. You know where I'm going with this, right? You guys are very smart. If you got a 93 on this test, you don't have to do this. If you're happy with 93, you don't have to. But if you still want to make up some extra points, maybe perhaps towards your first test, right? Because every exam is worth the same weight. So you can do this. By Wednesday, this Wednesday, what is today? 5th, April 7th. If you correct all of your mistakes, so if you got a 50 on this test, you're going to have to correct all of the mistakes worth 50 points, right? But I'm not going to return the entire 50 points back to you. Just like the first test, I will return 50% of your deductions. So if you got a 50 on this test, you lost 50 points. If you correct all of your mistakes, you get 50% of 50 points back, which is 25 points. So you'll get a total of 75 on this test. So if you got 93, you lost 7 points. So you correct those 7 point mistakes, then you get 3.5 back, so you get 96.5. Still, 93 is an A, 96.5 is an A, but you could probably use extra points towards either the first test or your final exam, which is coming up. Does that make sense? Again, it's optional. You don't have to do it if you got a 93, unless you really want to, but if you got, let's say, 44 or 30 or 24 on this test, I would highly recommend that you do. Okay, I think everyone should do that. Even if you got 80 on this test, you could get 10 points back and it will bring up your grade from a B to an A. Comfortable A, right? Does that make sense? Okay, I'm gonna give you until Wednesday to do this. Just like your quizzes, if you want me to check your work, again, I highly encourage you guys to do that. I know some of you guys still don't. Actually, in this class, I think most of you do already. I'm checking. Yeah, I think almost all of you, with an exception of maybe one or two, send me your work. Again, it's not that I want more work because I'm kind of tired from grading. But again, I think it really helps if you learn from your mistakes rather than me just returning your mistakes back to you, hoping that you would look at your mistakes and learn from them. I'm going to make you learn from your mistakes by going through this procedure with you. So by Wednesday, or actually before Wednesday, send me your work for me to check. And then I will work with you to make those corrections. And then by Wednesday, it will be due. I know I haven't posted the test on Canvas. I won't be able to do it until I'm done with teaching today, which will be around 12:30. So I will post the test around 12:30 then. Is that okay? Okay. Very good. Very good. Okay. So let's get back to where we left off. This is week 12, guys. We don't have a lot of time and we have very difficult topics still remaining. Chapter 3 isn't bad, but I'm just worried about the next final chapters. So let me see. Oh, and then you have a quiz coming up this Friday, by the way. I know I'm going to give you the makeup by Wednesday, but I don't want to delay our progress from the rest of the topics because it won't be fair to those who did really well on the test. So not to delay their progress, I'm going to give your quiz number 6, which will be due by Friday, and it will be just under sure stress. But before we do, I think I want to talk about your couple of homework problems. I don't know if you guys had a chance to look at your homework. Oops, I gotta disappear first. Hold on. You don't want to look at my ceiling. Okay. This is homework problem 3.3. And I chose this one to go over with you because unless it's like written straightforward, I'm afraid that you guys are gonna have trouble kind of analyzing the problem itself. Because I've seen this in chapter 1 with you guys. So let's go over this one. Take a look at this. So we have a hollow cylindrical shaft. And notice the information given. The length of the shaft is 2.4 meters. But what do 30 millimeters and 45 millimeters represent?
The inside and outside diameter of this pipe?
I am so, and some of you guys are nodding at what Jason just said. And I knew someone was going to say, like, and I'm glad Jason said the way he did. But what's wrong with what Jason said?
It's the radius.
Ah, very good. I think that was Bobby. So Jason said these are diameters, and it's very easy for us to assume that they are diameters because we're so used to seeing diameters, but they're tricking us here. They're not really diameters, but instead they're radii of the inner and the outer circles, right? So be careful with the given information. That's the first thing. That's a common mistake. So we're asked to solve for part B, for part A, determine the torque T that causes a maximum shearing stress of 45 megapascal in the hollow cylindrical shaft. So we're given the shearing stress. So again, this is a straightforward problem. So let me start with the formula for the shearing stress. And I know it's been a while since we saw this formula. But the maximum shear stress, again, the Greek letter would be tau, is equal to T times the lowercase c, that is not a subscript notation, divided by J. And again, what is J? What is J? What do we call J? I like it when I see you guys. Very good. Very good. I like it when I see you guys flipping through your notes. That means you guys have this information in your notebook. It's the polar moment of inertia. Very good. And we have to make sure that we use the right formula for the polar moment of inertia because this is hollow. Then here comes the difficult question. What is C? What does the lowercase c represent?
Maximum radial distance. Oh.
Sorry. Jaehyun, go ahead.
Maximum radial distance from center.
From the center, the longitudinal axis. Very good. Okay, very good. So we're looking for the torque, T. That's my unknown. So again, typically I just rewrite the formula before I plug into the formula because I think it's easier if you do the manipulation of the formula before you make substitutions. So I'm looking for T. So I got the maximum shear stress times the polar moment of inertia divided by C. Yeah, before I make the substitution, I just want to go over the formulas with you. J is the polar moment of inertia for hollow. So if you guys recall the formula, the outside diameter raised to the power of 4 minus the inside diameter raised to the power of 4 divided by 32. Again, of course, your textbook uses the formula that has the radii, but since I've been using the diameters, I'm just going to write it like this. Divided by the lowercase c, which should be 1/2, because it's the maximum radial distance from the longitudinal axis. 1/2 the diameter. We talked about this before. What diameter should this be? Should this be 1/2 of the inside diameter, or should it be the outside diameter?
Outside.
Ty, can you say that again? I missed the first part.
Outside.
Very good. It's the outside. Okay. So now let's go ahead and start to plug it in. What was our maximum shear stress? It's 45 megapascal or Newton divided by millimeter square. Then I got the constant of pi divided by 32. Then my outside diameter raised to the power of 4, but we're not given the outside diameter. We're given instead the outside radius of, what was it, 45 millimeters. So the outside diameter is 90 millimeters. The inside diameter given is 30. Therefore, the inside diameter is 60. Typically, we are given the diameters. This is just an unusual problem. So I got 90 raised to the power of 4 minus 60 raised to the power of 4. Which is 1/2 the outside diameter. So that would be 90. Okay, so let's take care of our units first. So I'm canceling out the millimeters, as many as I can. I got millimeter square, canceling out millimeter power to the 4. Then I got millimeters in the denominator. Again, canceling out the millimeters in the numerator. And I get 516 8901.6629 Newton times millimeters. Then I'm going to make my answer look a little bit simpler. I'm just going to carry out. You don't have to convert it to kilonewtons or convert to kilonewtons, but I'm going to do that anyway. Then, of course, millimeters to meters, because that's the standard. Will I take points off for not converting the units? Most likely not, not for stuff like this. And so the torque that induces the maximum shear stress of 45 megapascal turns out to be 5.17 kilonewton times meter, or what is it? 5,168,901 newtons millimeters, right? So part A, I'm not too concerned about, except for the fact that students are likely to make mistakes with the diameters versus the radii. So that was my main concern for A. But it's part B that you need to read very carefully if you're given a problem like this. And you've seen a problem something similar to this in chapter one, the way it was worded. So let's take a look at part B. says determine the maximum shear stress. So that sounds pretty harmless. We're looking for the maximum shear stress by the same torque T in a solid cylindrical shaft of the same cross-sectional area. So there's a lot going on here. So this, even though it doesn't say to refer to part A, that's what it's referring to. The same torque from where? From part A. And what was that torque? It was this huge number here, right? 5,168,901 newton millimeters, or 5.17 kilonewtons meter. So that's the same torque, but it says it's for a solid. So we're going from a hollow to a solid, but maintaining the same cross-sectional area. So we have to have the same area. But what was the area for the hollow shaft in part A? Did we ever figure that out? We did not, because we didn't have to, right? So let's go ahead and solve for that first. So same torque, T, as in part A. So we got that, we found that. Then we have to have the same cross-sectional area. And what was that area for the hollow? Well, let's find out what that is. Now, be careful with the formula for the area, because it does look similar to the J, the polar moment of inertia, right? So be careful with that. Our outside. Okay, so that was the cross-sectional area for the hollow shaft. So it's saying that we have to maintain the same area for the solid. So by setting them equal to each other, what are we looking for? Its diameter has to change. Okay, because we're given a cylindrical shaft that is hollow. So what would be the diameter that has the same cross-sectional area as of that hollow, right, for the solid? So I got the area 3534.2917 millimeter square equal to the area of a solid cross-section, which is pi d square over 4. So of course, pi over 4 is a constant. Only thing that's missing here is the diameter. Of course, this is not a final answer, but it's an important part of this analysis. So this is the diameter of the solid. Shaft. Now we're looking for the maximum shear stress for this solid shaft that is the same cross-sectional area as that of the hollow shaft, plus the same torque. Well, our torque, as in part A, I'm going to write this in terms of newtons and millimeters. 5,168,901.6629 newton times millimeters. And the maximum radial distance should be 1/2 the outside diameter, or in this case, the diameter of the solid, which is 67.0820 millimeters, divided by the polar moment of inertia, which is pi over 32 times the diameter raised to the power of 4. I've got millimeter square being canceled out. So we're left with Newton divided by millimeter square. And that's the unit I wanted to have because I can have the megapascal as my unit. And since we're out of space down here, my maximum shear stress works out to 87.2 megapascal. Okay, now this doesn't have to be difficult, but it's reading part B in relation to part A. I think I've said this in the beginning of the semester. In this textbook, when you read the homework problems, sometimes even though they're broken down into part A, part B, part C, sometimes you have to read the entire thing together to really understand the problem statement. Did I do something wrong, Jaehyun, or is this okay? Because I see you checking something. Did I do something wrong? Let me see.
No, I'm just going through it.
Okay. Questions on this one? Let me see. Okay. So your quiz this week, which will be assigned on Wednesday, will be similar to your homework problems and the class notes. Okay, let's do one more because every time students see something like this, they get a little scared. Very likely you're going to see something similar to this in your final exam. Okay, oh, by the way, when is your final exam? I wrote it down. Your final exam, according to the school schedule, is going to be on Wednesday, May 5th. From 8 a.m. until 10:30 a.m., 2.5 hours. Wednesday, May 5th, 8 to 10:30 a.m. The schedule is out in case you guys want to check. If you guys are taking any other live classes, make sure there is no conflict. If there is, you have to notify your instructors ASAP. For the final exam? The final exam will start from chapter 3. But we still have chapters 4 and 5 and 7. So we have a lot to cover. Usually 4 and 5 are covered together. I don't really separate the chapter 4. I just integrate into chapter 5. This is continues to deal with the moment of inertia. Okay, so let's take a look at this picture. It looks scary at first. But when you see a problem like this, there is an example problem I did with you before the test that should remind you of something like this. Can you guys look through your notes and see which one that would be? I just want to make sure you guys have it for your quiz and the test. Have you guys found the example problem? Let's make sure that we finished. I think we did. So here you have a shaft. It doesn't tell us the length because we don't need to have the length. And it's got 4 discs, pulleys. Sometimes they can be gears. It's the last example we did before the test. Do you guys have that? Do we finish it?
I don't think so.
I thought we did.
No, we did.
I could be wrong. So what do we get for part A? Let's make sure we finished it.
Is it the 63.7 megapascal?
Oh, okay, good. What about part B, Dailene?
That would be 255 megapascal.
Oh, okay, so we did finish it. Good, thank you, thank you. Okay, so we did finish it. So even though this problem looks a little different from the class example, they're essentially the same thing, same ideas. They just look different. And this problem is really getting you ready for the next topic coming up in chapter 3. So let's take a look at this. Under the normal operating conditions, the electric motor, which is at A, that's a picture of a motor. I know that it doesn't tell you that, but that's a motor. Exerts a torque of 2.4 kilonewtons meter on shaft AB. Knowing that each shaft is solid, determine the maximum shear stress in shaft AB, shaft BC, and shaft CD. First of all, maybe I forgot to mention this. It looks like a continuous shaft, and it is, and it looks pretty much the same, but your shaft doesn't have to have the same diameter all the way. Your diameters can vary as well, and therefore the torque can be different, the torque supply can be different, and therefore the shearing stress obviously will be different. Okay, so when it says that the motor exerts a torque of 2.4 kilonewtons meter on shaft AB, you have to first analyze. So what is the effect of that internally on the shaft? So if I see a problem like this, I would think and analyze in terms of segments. So you have the segments AB, BC, CD, and then finally DE. Can you guys see the breakdown of the entire shaft? Okay, so again, in parts, just like the last example we did in class. This one is pretty straightforward. There's really no trickery here, again, because it's getting, it's just simply asking you what is the stress, right? Just like the last example problem. Now, later on in chapter 3, this will become a little bit more complex. And there, I remember telling you there are three parts to chapter 3. All three concepts will be integrated into a problem that looks just like this. So this is just the part one of what you're about to see at the end of chapter 3. So I'm going to pass a cutting plane through each segment. Do I have a bigger picture? No, I don't. Use a different. So I'm going to pass a cutting plane between the motor at A and my first disc at B. So I'm going to pass a cutting plane right here through the shaft, another cutting plane through this, and then through CD. Now, do I need to pass a cutting plane through DE, the final segment of the shaft? I don't, because there's no question asking me about that, right? So I got three cutting planes. I'm going to start with shaft AB because that's part A. When you pass a cutting plane, you have to decide again, do I analyze the section to the left or to the right of my cutting plane? And I'm going to go from left to right. And I said this to you before, when you choose a side, be consistent throughout. So I'm going to look at the left side of the cutting plane. I'm going to start with my free body diagram. Here's my motor, and here is my shaft, and here's my cutting plane. I gotta put the entire shaft and its torx in equilibrium. We've done this before, so sum of the torque gotta equal to zero. This is like saying sum of the moment is equal to zero. It's exactly the same actually. So this motor is exerting a torque of 2.4 kilonewtons. So I'm gonna say that T sub A, 2.4 kilonewtons meter. And I need to solve for, this is segment AB. So I'm looking for the resisting, internal resisting torque that I'm calling T sub AB. Now let me see, counter. What would be the direction of rotation of the torque exerted by the motor to the shaft?
It appears everything's spinning counterclockwise.
So what should the torque, the direction of the torque be by the motor?
Clockwise.
Very good. Why would you say clockwise? Now, Jason has noted that the three torques that are applied, they're all rotating counterclockwise about the longitudinal axis, right? Right here, counterclockwise, counterclockwise, and counterclockwise. Now, Jae-hyun said, well, then the torque provided by the motor should be clockwise. And that's because the entire system, right, has to be equal to zero. So you got T sub A clockwise plus, what were the other ones? 1.2 plus 0.8 plus 0.4. When you add up the three applied torques, you get 2.4, right? Equal to zero. So your T sub A, 2.4 kilonewtons meter, gotta be clockwise because the motor is keeping the other torques checked. So let's say this is a clockwise, right? So I got I'm going to assume then T sub AB gotta be counterclockwise, so positive minus 2.4 counterclockwise. Remember I said to you before the test, what's going to separate some of you from the rest of you is in the details. And in the class example that I shared with you, we solved for the resisting torque, the internal resisting torque, right? I think we had the wall before. And even though there is no wall, it's got the motor here. Once you have the internal resisting torque, we can then go straight to our formula for the maximum shear stress. This is for T sub AB. So we got 2.4 and 1/2 of, what's the diameter there for AB? I know you can't see it because of my cross-section in plane, but let me erase that here. And it's given as 54. Scroll that down so you guys can see. I'm going to carry out my unit conversions. First of all, I'm going to change the kilonewtons to newtons because I want to have my unit of megapascal. carry out one more conversion because I got millimeters everywhere except 4 meters. So I got 1 meter equivalent to 1,000 millimeters. Then I got millimeter squares in the numerator, which you're going to cancel out part of millimeter to the power of 4. So now looking at my units, I got newtons divided by millimeter square, or that will give me megapascal. So in part A, the maximum shear stress induced for shaft AB works out to 77.6 megapascal. If I were to give you a problem like this in the future, and if you do not show me the work with a free body diagram and the work by using the equilibrium equation to find the internal resisting torque, I will be asking you, how did you get to 0.4 in your formula? If you cannot justify it, I will be taking points off for that. Let's continue to part B. After this, it's pretty much the same process. This is for BC, which is the next part. Again, I already showed you that I'm going to pass a cutting plane between the two discs of B and C. Since I start to look at the left side, I'm going to continue to look at the left side. I'm going to start with my mortar here at the end. Then I have a shaft with my first disc at B. Then I pass a cutting plane somewhere through between B and C. Now I know that T sub A is equal to 2.4 kilonewtons meter, and this is a clockwise rotation. So let me just indicate that here before I forget. And in the picture, there's 1.2 kilonewton meter at B that is counterclockwise. So this is my gear. So counterclockwise, 1.2 kilonewtons meter. I'm solving for the internal resisting torque that I'm calling T sub BC, because it's the torque between the shaft segments of B and C. Again, the equation of equilibrium, sum of the torque gotta equal to zero. I'm gonna start from the left-hand side, negative 2.4 kilonewton meter plus 1.2 kilonewton meter plus T sub BC, internal resisting torque in the shaft BC. I wrote this T sub BC as a positive. So let's just do a little review here. What does that mean by positive? What am I trying to say if I say plus T sub BC?
It's counterclockwise.
Counterclockwise.
Very good. I am assuming that my T sub BC should be counterclockwise. That's my assumption. Again, just like in your statics and in this class, you are going to assume the senses, or in this case, the direction of rotations. If my answer comes out as positive, that means my assumed sense is correct. So my T sub BC works out to 1.2. And it comes out positive, meaning that my assumed sense of rotation is correct, which was counterclockwise. Okay. So let's solve for the maximum shear stress. Same thing. TC over J, it's a repeat, 1.2. For this segment of the shaft, diameter is 46. So we're going to take half of 46. And again, I'm going to carry out two conversions. There is a lot of repetition here. Let me scroll this up. Again, I'm left with Newton millimeter square. So the maximum stress works out to 62.8 megapascal. Now notice that even though we are determining the direction of rotation of individual torques, we do not necessarily take that direction of rotation into consideration when solving for the stress. So meaning this, even if you get the direction of rotation wrong for your torque, is that really critical in determining the maximum shear stress? Absolutely not. So it's okay if you don't quite get the right direction. However, in the next topic, if you get the direction of rotation wrong, it will make a huge difference. That's why even though I don't need to really have the direction of rotation, I am already establishing that ground for you so that you will continue to do it for the next topic. Let's do part C quickly. Again, a repeat. This is the last segment of the shaft CD. Again, when you draw your free body diagram, I know it's painful, but you have to be consistent in your work. This is my motor. First part of the shaft, here's my diskette B. Second shaft, this is the diskette C, right? And then I am passing a cutting plane through between C and D. Again, my T sub A is given to 0.4. This was clockwise, right? 1.2. This is counterclockwise, and 0.8. Sorry, I'm squeezing it in there. Counterclockwise. And we're looking for T sub CD. So I got the three applied torques, negative 2.4 for clockwise, 1.2 and 0.8 for counterclockwise. Then I am assuming that my T sub CD, the internal resisting torque in shaft CD is positive, assuming that this is going to be a counterclockwise rotation. And I do get a positive 0.4 kilonewtons meter. This is counterclockwise. For this part of the shaft, diameter is 46. That has not changed. Oops, 46. Again, oh, sorry, keep sliding it. Two conversions. And for this segment of the shaft, the maximum shear stress works out to 20.9 megapascal. So if you look at all the three parts, the procedure is exactly the same. The only thing that really changes is the internal resisting torque and the diameter. And the work for the internal resisting torque, you have to show as part of your analysis. If you don't, I will be taking points off for incomplete work or lack of justification. Now, I didn't do this one with you, but 3.10 is similar to this. 3.10. So make sure to, you know, I don't usually assign too many homework problems, so make sure to go over every single one, okay? Because they're meant to help you. Questions on this before we continue? It wasn't so bad.
1.2 kilonewton and the 0.8, were they given to us?
Oh, yeah. They were given to us in the problem.
I see it now. I see it now.
Yeah. No, I didn't make them up. Okay, very good. Anything else? Okay. Again, I want you guys to learn how to break it apart into parts. It's a lot easier. And it really, this is the only way you should really do it, honestly. Now, it doesn't matter whether you go from left to right or from right to left, because if it's satisfying equilibrium, it should be the same anyway. Okay, no questions, then let me go.
Okay, I have a question.
Sure.
Are we going to have like similar problems where there's going to be like gears involved, so some of them will be rotating in different directions?
Yeah, of course. Of course. Yes, you will. Yes, you will. Let me see. Where's my homework? I don't have the entire homework solution with me. But if you look at problem 3.10, they have torques applied going in different directions. So yes, of course. This is why it's important to keep track of the direction of rotations, either as positive or negative, because it will definitely affect your resisting torque, right? So it's really important to take a note of that. Now, when it comes to the shear stress, even though I determined the internal resisting torque as either, you know, counterclockwise or clockwise, I didn't take that, the sign, either the negative or the positive. Well, in this case, everything turned out to be counterclockwise, I thought, right? I didn't take that into consideration for the shear stress. But the next topic, which we're about to do, determine the angle of twist, you definitely need to keep track of whether it's a clockwise rotation or counterclockwise rotation, because that will determine the total angle of twist. So it's really important, but not for the shear stress, not so much. Let me see, stop the sharing on this one. Let me go back to your class notes. Okay. Use the red for now so it stands out. Okay, so this is our next topic, part two of chapter three, which is covered in section 3.2, angle of twist in the elastic range. Again, remember I told you, even though we went over the stress and the strain curve and the ranges or the phases start from elastic to plastic and strain and hardening range for ductile materials. We tend to focus only in the elastic range because that is our safe ground. Okay, so your textbook tends to stay in the first phase or the first range of the stress and the strain curve, where everything goes back to being normal when the load is released. So again, you've seen a picture like this before with me, right? You should be now comfortable with this. So using that, a similar picture here that you've seen before with me. So here is my straight line AB, which is on the outer surface of the shaft. And you may recall from our previous notes that when you rotate the shaft, in this case, what is this? Clockwise rotation with respect to the longitudinal axis, your straight line AB will now assume a curved line of AB prime. Okay, now in this part, we're going to focus right here. And as B becomes B prime, the angle that is formed from its original position to its final position, there's a change in angle, and we're going to call that angle phi. This is known as the angle of twist. That angle that is assumed after rotation is called the angle of twist. I have it in the next slide. So here, so again, AB is a straight line on the outer surface of the shaft, right? We know that because we used the same line before. AB prime is a curve that represents the deformation line that AB assumes after the torque is applied to the shaft. We know that. The radius OB now becomes OB prime. We know that from our previous discussion. And we kind of talked about this too, but we didn't really go into it. The total deformation of line AB, right? Meaning the change in that is BB prime. So that would be your delta, right? Oh, I have it here, delta. And the shear strain is then equal to, this is from your chapter 2 formula. So it's going to be BB prime over L. But this is important here because this pertains to our circular shaft. Since the shaft is circular in cross section, and that's what we deal with, the polar moment of inertia because of its circular nature. The magnitude of BB prime is C times V. Again, what is V? It's your angle of twist. And what is C again? That is the maximum radial distance. Or simply, if you're looking at a circle that we're calling C here, that's really the radius of the circle, right? Not just, you know, but in this case, since we can analyze at any given point with a distance of rho from the longitudinal axis, we do make that distinction that C is the maximum. But it, really, if you're analyzing a circle, that's the radius. And so why are we taking this relationship here? BB prime is C times the phi. Okay. If you look at the... So OB becomes OB prime, right? And you can see the angle right here, which is the phi. So it's saying that C is right here and the C is still the same. C does not change because the plane remains a plane, okay? And OB, the distance OB, a straight line, is the same as OB prime. That C remains the same. Oh, I went too far. Therefore, we're going to replace our BB prime in terms of C times the phi. And that really comes from your the properties of, where is it? The circle, okay? Properties of the circle. This is where I wanna further discuss here. Assuming that Hooke's law applies. Again, what was that, Hooke's law? What do you guys recall about Hooke's law from chapter 2?
That's the spring equation, isn't it?
Not in this case, because we don't have any springs. From chapter 2, what is Hooke's law? That was related to the proportional limit. So when we say the proportional limit, oh, I cannot write vertically. Oh, there's someone in the chat. Let me see. Very good. Strain is proportional to stress. That's what it means, right? So the modulus of rigidity, and this is equivalent to E, right? The modulus of elasticity, except that modulus of rigidity applies to the strain, whereas the modulus of elasticity refers to the stress. So the modulus of rigidity is equal to stress over strain, oh, sorry, shear strain. Let me see. I meant to say shear and normal, not the stress and the strain. Shear stress and the shear strain. So you have the tau over gamma. But we're saying that gamma from our observation can be replaced by what's in the yellow box above. So let's go ahead and substitute that in here. So I got strain is equal to using the maximum radial distance of C times the angle phi divided by the length of the shaft. Now rewriting this, I can say tau times L over C times phi. Now I want to find the maximum, the angle phi. Let's see. Why did I go from here? Oh, this. Use a different color. I'm going to use it in terms of the maximum. So rewriting the phi, we're going from here to phi, the next line here. I got right, and then I got g times c. Can you guys see that? But I want to focus on this tau, which is your stress. That is to be, we're going to use it for maximum. Why did I put the maximum there? Why did I go from just a regular tau to a maximum?
We're figuring out the angle change now, so we're gonna need the maximum torque that would produce that.
But how do I know that it should be a maximum stress? What is in the formula that kind of tells me that, hey, you gotta look for the maximum? Not just any tau, but the maximum stress. It's in the formula. It's this. If it were any given row, then that would be some. Can I rewrite? If it was any given row, then it could be any given tau or shear stress at any random point. But C is a special case. That is your maximum distance. Right? So if it's maximum, then the stress associated with the maximum distance gotta be a maximum shear stress. Okay, so rewriting this, I'm gonna take the maximum shear stress and replace it with the formula that we know. Okay. So we know that maximum shear stress is equal to T times C over J. So I made that substitution. Then cleaning this up, we get what's inside this box. So the angle phi, the angle of twist, is equal to T times L divided by J over G. TL over JG. Okay, now we have our formula for the shear stress. This is your next important formula for finding the angle of twist. Now, why do we care about the angle of twist? If you think about a shaft, let's say you have, so it's really looking for how rigid or how flexible is the shaft. Okay, so the angle of twist is related to, in layman's term, how flexible is it or how rigid is it to withstand the amount of torque. So here is your formula again for the angle of twist. For everything, we pretty much know every letter here. T, obviously, is the applied torque. I put the word externally, but of course, the internal resisting torque to satisfy the equilibrium. L is referring to the length of the shaft. Before, with our shear stress, we didn't really care for about the length. But when you determine the angle of twist, its flexibility, the length is really important. J, again, is the polar moment of inertia, and G, this is referring to the shear, right? Modulus of rigidity. So this is just like your letter E, which is for the normal, but this is for shear. It's the same idea. Now I'm going to start with an easy example problem. Now for part A, I don't have to ask you for the maximum shear stress, but typically when problems are assigned in chapter 3, your stress and the angle of twist kind of go hand in hand. So we have a 38 millimeter diameter, which is solid. Yeah, okay, that's okay. 2 meters in length, subjected to a torque of 600 Newton meters. Calculate the maximum shear stress and the angle of twist, given that the modulus of rigidity is 79.3 times 10 to the power of 3 megapascal. So part A, we already have to know how to do, and I'm just going to give you the answer for this, since we don't have a lot of time. This works out 255.7 megapascal. Okay. I cannot write vertically. 55.7 megapascal, so you guys can check that out. Given the time that we got, very little. For part B, for the total angle of twist, you're going to use the angle phi, TL over JG. Let me do this one very quickly for you. This is solid. So I'm replacing my J, the polar moments of inertia, with pi D to the power of 4 divided by 32. Our torque given is 600 Newton meter. The length given is 2 meters. Our diameter is 38 to the power of 4. G given is 79, where is it, 0.3 megapascal. Now you guys can convert to meters or to millimeters, but I like to keep everything in millimeters. So I'm going to carry out one conversion factor. So I'm going to carry out a conversion to convert these meters squared to millimeter square. So this is where you have to be careful. One square meter square. Everything has to be squared. 1,000 square millimeter square. That way I get to cancel out my meter square. This is canceled out. Now this gets canceled out. All of my millimeters have been canceled out, leaving us with the unit of Newton here, but then Newton cancels out this Newton. So what unit is left after all these cancellations? There's no unit, right? And that's because we're measuring the
angle of
twist. Very good, it's the radians, right? So the angle of twist works out to 0.0739 radians. The formula is written in radians because there is no angle here, but we should convert this to degrees. So we're going to convert it using this conversion factor, 180 degrees over pi, which will give us the angle of twist of 4.24 degrees. So this is a key, the conversion. Sorry I kept you guys for two longer minutes, but I just wanted to show you this in case you guys want to get started with your next homework. But we will continue with the angle of twist and we'll go into more details on Wednesday. Okay. Again, I won't be posting your test a copy of the test until I'm done with my classes. I have another class right after yours. So I'll post the test, the entire test on in Canvas after around 12:30 when I get done. But I know some of you guys have your problems written down, so you guys can get started with your corrections. Send me your work before you submit it on Wednesday. I want to see every single one of your papers before you submit it. Very good. I will see you guys on Wednesday. Bye.